I hope you all had a nice weekend. I actually traveled to Minnesota for my 30th high school reunion, which was fun, especially since I didn't get to watch the Dodgers lose. So it was, didn't have to suffer through that. Okay, how many people here found the lecture last Friday on VDJ recombination to be confusing? It's okay, you can raise your hand. Yeah, it's a hard lecture to understand, it's a hard lecture to deliver. And upon reflection, I think a good thing to do before you try to dig into those notes in chapter four is to go back to chapter three, the introduction to adaptive immunity, and read the sections about gene rearrangement, because I think it gives a more gentle introduction to the concepts before you get into the details. And it might just be a little more clear if you've seen that once before, before you sit down to really understand the details like the RSS sequences and the 1223 rule. But just step back and understand the idea of gene segments that recombine to make a functional gene. And then when you go to study chapter four, as I emphasize, pay attention to what happens at the level of DNA recombination, what happens at the level of mRNA splicing and processing, and how that translates into production of the final protein in the different forms, secreted versus transmembrane, IgM versus IgD. Well, today we're going to complete our discussion of diversity generation in antibodies and start to talk about the functions of antibodies. And first we'll talk about somatocopy mutation, or SHM. So far everything we talked about, generation of heavy chains and light chains through VDJ recombination, all that occurs in the bone marrow in B cells that are developing that have not yet encountered antigen, and the goal is to produce a diverse repertoire of B cells so that you'll always have a few clones that can respond to any particular pathogen. Somatocopy mutation and the other process we'll talk about today, class of recombination, occur only after a B cell clone has recognized antigen and has started to proliferate and receive help from T cells. And during this process, one clone of B cells becomes many identical B cells, but they're not really identical because each one undergoes a mutation process that changes its antibody variable domains in a different way. And so each of the daughter cells of the original B cell clone will express an antibody with a slightly different variation of the original sequence. And what's really surprising and fascinating about this process is that it's confined to the variable regions and not to other parts of the antibody or even other genes in the genome. So figure 427 shows you that if you look at the frequency of mutations that occurs during this process, they're really concentrated in the gene segments of the V and the J for the light chain, or V, D, and J for heavy chain. You might find a few in the untranslated region here and starting in the intron over here. But if you look at other genes in the genome, or if you look at the constant regions, constant region exons, you don't find mutations there. One thing we know about the process is that it requires an enzyme known as AID. So you don't call it AID because people will get that confused with the disease AIDS. People call it AID, and that stands for activation-induced cytosine deaminase. And this is an enzyme that's only expressed in activated B cells. Now, last time I told you about RAG1 and RAG2, that's only expressed in early developing B cells or developing T cells. AID is not expressed at those times. It's only expressed in activated B cells, and it's essential for the process of somatocopy mutation. What it does, it's drawn to the rearranged VJ or VDJ segments of the heavy and light chains. And there, it converts cytosine bases to uracil. So that's its job. It's a cytidine deaminase. It converts cytosine to uracil. And then DNA repair processes come in and convert that to other bases through various processes. And that leads to point mutations that change the sequence of the DNA in these variable domains. It's still unknown why the AID enzyme is particularly focused or recruited to these V region exons. But that's what has been observed. And it's important because if you had mutation throughout the genome, you would have an increased risk of cancer. So what that means is, let's say you have a clone of B cells that binds to a particular antigen with a reasonable affinity, and then 100 daughter cells are produced. Each one of those is going to have a slightly different sequence. And those different B cells are selected and distinguish from each other by kind of a Darwinian process of natural selection, those that have higher affinity for the antigen than the original B cell will get a survival signal because their B cell receptor can bind the antigen better. And those that have worse affinity, or the mutation causes the protein to be unfolded or a stop codon, those will no longer be able to bind the antigen and they don't get that survival signal and they die. And even any B cell that doesn't change its sequence at all and doesn't increase its affinity probably will not win this competition. There's a random process with different clones, and those that increase affinity win the competition or be able to bind the antigen, and that gives them the survival signal. During the stage of somatic copy mutation, the B cells are programmed to just die unless they get that survival signal. So it's like everybody's trying to swim towards the life raft, otherwise they're going to drown, and the ones that swim the best, the ones with the highest affinity, just by this random mutation process, will be the ones that are selected to survive. And if you look at the course of the somatocopy mutation over time, as they've shown in figure 428, if you look 1 week after primary immunization, let's forget about IgM and IgM, IgG here. Just look at the heavy chain variable region and the light chain variable region. And then 2 weeks after immunization, each red rectangle here represents a point mutation. You can see that some occur in the framework regions like this one here, but many occur, or more occur, in the CDR loops. And over time, there are more mutations, but they tend to congregate in or near the CDR loops. And the reason is because if you have a mutation that occurs in a framework region, more than likely it's going to disrupt the structure of that beta sheet. Maybe you'll lose the cysteine that's needed to make the disulfide bond. If you have a mutation that affects a framework region, it's unlikely to increase the affinity, because affinity is dictated entirely by the CDR loops. More likely it's going to disrupt the basic stability of the heavier light chain. So only mutations in CDR loops tend to increase affinity or even retain affinity. And in the initial stages, those might expand. You might have some daughter cells that win that early battle, and they continue to divide and continue to accumulate more mutations. And you can see some mutations that maybe have increased affinity are now fixed, and additional mutations have happened, so you get additional diversification. But over time, that leads to a progressive increase in the affinity of the surviving B cells. And that process is called affinity maturation. Just to say it again, what this figure is trying to illustrate is that if you look at the surviving B cells over time, the mutations that occur congregate or clustered in the CDR loops, because that's the region that contacts antigen. That's going to determine whether it has higher affinity or not. You can get mutations in the framework regions if they don't disrupt the structure and they're sort of silent and not deleterious. But usually a mutation in the framework region will tend to disrupt the structure of the antibody. So only those mutations that affect the CDR loops are those that can increase the affinity, and those B cells win the survival contest. Any questions about that? Yeah.
So this is after the B cells have already, like, they found one and they started proliferating, but then they're kind of still making differences after they're proliferating from the original one?
Right. So it's very different. So the original B cell clones are this army of a billion different B cells. Those are generated by VDJ recombination. That's random. It's independent of antigen. It happens in the bone marrow. It's just creating the army. And then it would be like a certain threat comes in, and we need the Navy SEALs, or we need the Air Force pilots or something like that. And then they're selected to fight that particular invader. And each one of them then has a chance to slightly change its role. And those that are particularly good at fighting that invader win out, and they continue on. And those that maybe aren't so good are lost. So this only happens when one clone or one part of the army is selected to expand. And then among the different daughters of that have different mutations, those with the best affinity win, and they continue on to divide and take over the response. So after a week, the affinity of the antibodies on the surface of these B cells is higher. After 2 weeks, it's even higher, because only those B cells that had increased affinity will be able to survive. And eventually, when they become plasma cells, the antibody that's secreted is generally higher affinity than the initial antibody that bound the pathogen in the first place 2 weeks prior. So we've talked about combinatorial diversity, junctional diversity, somatotype mutation. Those all change the variable region, but there's another process that changes the constant region. And that's what we'll talk about next. This figure is just to remind you that there's 9 different isotypes that can be made. There's 4 subclasses of IgG and 2 of IgA. Their heavy chains have a Greek symbol. Forget about the sizes for now. And they're just ranked, for the most part, in order of their abundance in the serum. Especially so, I mean, among the IgGs, the IgG1 is most abundant, and then IgA1 is more abundant than IgA2. That detail isn't what I want to emphasize here. It's just that the different isotypes are found in different amounts in the blood, and they have different half-lives in the serum. So they're fundamentally different from each other, where they are, how long they hang around, and so on. And you remember from, this is basically the picture we saw before, they have slightly different structures, different numbers of Ig-like domains, different position of the disulfide bonds, different flexibility in the hinge region, different glycosylation. And we'll spend the second half of this lecture and the beginning of the next lecture talking about the unique functions of the different isotypes. But what I want to talk about now is how you generate those isotypes. And if you can think about one B-cell clone, setting aside the somatotype mutation for now, and just imagine that you have one antigen specificity that's dictated by the variable region made up of the VH and the VL domains. That antigen specificity can be hooked up to different constant regions by a process called isotype switching. And it makes sense to look back at the genome sequence, at the DNA sequence, so that it starts to make sense. Remember that the V, D, and J gene segments are 5' of the constant region exons. And after recombination to produce a functional heavy chain, you have a VDJ exon with its leader mini exon. And this, as I told you last time, is close to the exons for the mu and delta chains. So in the initial transcript that's produced can be spliced differently to make IgM heavy chains, or IgD. And then you have a series of other heavy chain exons. Shown here is the exons for IgG3, IgG1, but you also have the other IgG isotypes, IgA isotypes, and IgE isotypes. And they're all just arranged downstream at the locus, separated by large distances in the DNA. So in a B cell that hasn't yet encountered antigen, it's making IgM and IgD from this transcript, and both are on the surface. If an antigen is encountered, at the same time that somatotype mutation is occurring to diversify the variable domain, the same enzyme, AID, has a role in changing the antibody isotype. And what happens is that there are switch regions, noted by these capital S's, that are just 5' of all these exon clusters. So there's one upstream of the mu exons. There's not one upstream of delta, because that's produced from the same transcript by splicing. But if you look at the gamma 3 or gamma 1 or other ones not shown here, like alpha, they all have what's known as a switch region. This is different from an RSS sequence. It's another type of recombination sequence. It doesn't have a heptamer nonamer or a spacer, and we're not going to talk about the specific structure of the switch regions and their characteristics. But they are sites that are that AID is drawn to and targets and introduces mutations here. And these are in introns. They're not in the coding sequence, so it doesn't affect the coding sequence of the antibody directly. But what happens is that leads to a double strand break at the switch regions. And you get, so actually what happens is that the AID, by altering the cytosine residues to uracil, and then the repair process leads to nicks on both strands, and then that leads to the pairing of those two nicked switch regions. So in this example, you have AID acting upstream of the gamma 1 exons and upstream of the mu exons, and then these are brought together, And you have a similar recombination that occurs for VDJ recombination in that the intervening DNA is brought together and lost from the genome, and the original genomic DNA is repaired. So now you have the VDJ exon that's been moved just upstream of the constant region exons to make IgG1. So just to go through it again, if the B cell wants to switch from making IgM and IgD to making another isotype, in this example IgG1, AID introduces mutations that lead to nicks in the switch regions upstream of the two exons that are being, sets of exons that are being selected for this process. And that leads to the bringing together of this nicked switch regions, and then a recombination process that removes all the intervening DNA and leaves you with a rearranged heavy chain locus with the variable domain exon here, now next to the exon for the new isotype. So now when you have transcription, the same variable domain is linked up to the IG domains of a different isotype. Okay, so one way that we know that AID is involved in this process is there is a rare human disease, a genetic disease, where patients lack AID, and they produce only IgM antibodies and a little bit of IgD, but not the other isotypes because they cannot do class switch recombination, CSR. Also, people who do not have AID cannot mediate somatic hypermutation, so their antibodies are generally low affinity. And it's sometimes called a hyper-IgM syndrome because they make IgM and they do not make IgG, IgA, or IgE. But in addition to making only IgM, these antibodies are of low affinity. Now this process is different than VDJ recombination in a couple of ways. VDJ recombination in the bone marrow, no antigen is involved, and it's random. CSR, or class switch recombination, occurs after antigen recognition, and it's not random. The switching is directed by cytokines produced by T cells. So depending on the environment and the pathogen, the T cell may produce cytokines that direct the B cell to make IgG1, or maybe IgA, or maybe IgE. And so that is tailored to the particular response and the particular pathogen that you're trying to eradicate. I'd also like to emphasize that not all B cells switch to different isotype. There are some B cells that become plasma cells that secrete IgM. There are even some that produce IgD, although they seem to be much more rare. And early on in an immune response, you generally make a wave of plasma cells that don't do any switching or somatic hypermutation and produce IgM of low affinity. It's only later on, a week or two after the initial B cell antigen encounter, that this process is completed and you start to get plasma cells that are secreting these other isotypes. One more thing I should say is that it's possible to switch more than once. So let's say the initial event, you switched from making IgM to making IgG3. You would lose the intervening DNA, but you would still be able to switch a second time to IgG1 or some other isotype if it's still around. If the first event was a switch to IgG1, you would have lost IgG3 exons from the genome and you couldn't switch to IgG3. But as long as there are additional exons for other isotypes still downstream at this locus, you could do a second switching event. Any questions about class switch recombination? So it's also different from BDJ because RAG proteins are not involved. It's the AID that's initiating the event. Yeah.
Do each exon for each of the isotypes appear only once in the genome, or are there?
Yes. Well, there's two. Yeah. So each exon appears only once in the genome. Obviously, everything is on two chromosomes, but since B cells only make one heavy chain, there's only one that's being transcribed and one that's involved in the class switch recombination. Just a finer point, each of these squares actually refers to a group of exons. You may remember for IgM, each little exon corresponds to one of the four Ig-like constant region domains. But they've just simplified it here to show one large exon. It's really a set of exons that encode all the constant region domains for that isotype. So why do we make all these different isotypes? That will be the subject of the second half of the lecture and the beginning of the next lecture. But just as a preview, you can see that they have different activities in terms of activating the complement system. Some are better than others. Some are better at opsonization or mediating killing by NK cells. Some are more involved in activating mast cells. They have different transport properties. But we'll come back to those in detail. So figure 435 is useful to review. And I'll just go through it again. The V region assembly from gene fragments, this refers to VDJ recombination, occurs in the bone marrow, and it involves somatic recombination of genomic DNA. We talked about generation of junctional diversity. That is because joining is imprecise, and you get additional nucleotides added, and then deletion of some germline nucleotides. These processes are irreversible, so the B cell, once they've done VDJ recombination, that's the sequence you're left with. We didn't talk about number three, so let's ignore that. We talked about production of IgM and IgD in the same mature B cell. You get transcription of one long message that can be alternatively spliced and processed, and B cells can make both IgM and IgD at the same time. In some cases, they may change to make only IgM or more of IgD, but this is something that is regulated depending on the stage of the B cell. And of course, they can change later to making another isotype. Changing from membrane to secreted also occurs by splicing and RNA processing. Somatic hypermutation and isotype switch occur in activated B cells in lymphoid tissue, secondary lymphoid tissue. They both require AID, and this is not a genomic recombination event, but it has to do with DNA repair of these mutations induced by AID. Isotype switch is somatic recombination, but through a different mechanism from the VDJ recombination. And I have a list of different, in the notes, I have a list of differences between VDJ rearrangement and isotype switching, just to help you remember, and you can go through that in your spare time. I just want to take a moment to point out really how remarkable these processes are. In no other cell in our bodies, or indeed in any organism that I know of, do you have intentional mutation of the DNA and recombination of the DNA. This process is normally very rare and usually bad for you. The reason we have DNA repair proteins like DNA PK and all those other ones in every cell is because we're being attacked by UV radiation and other stresses all the time that could damage our DNA and lead to death of the cell or even worse, you know, cancer. So there must be a good reason to have these events. It's in the organism's interest to prevent mutations and DNA breaks and repair them. And sometimes that goes wrong. In fact, a lot of leukemias and lymphomas, which are tumors of the immune system, they arise because of mistakes that are made during VDJ recombination or class switch recombination or somatic hypermutation. If AID doesn't get targeted just to the V region, if it mutates some tumor suppressor gene or oncogene, that can lead to a cancer. If the DNA breaks aren't repaired properly and you have, instead of V and J fusion, you have a V segment brought to an oncogene so that it's actively transcribed, you get cancer. And some of the most famous B cell cancers are caused by errors in these processes. So there clearly must be a really strong environment or evolutionary pressure to have these processes in the face of the fact that they increase our chances of getting cancer. And basically, it's a trade-off. If we want to survive this world with all kinds of pathogens, we have to have a diverse repertoire of B cells and T cells. We have to be able to increase antibody affinity by somatic hypermutation. We have to have a number of different isotypes that we can do generate by class switch combination. If not, we're not going to make it to the age of reproduction. It's as simple as that. You need an adaptive immune system with a huge repertoire and the flexibility to change sequences to deal with the immense number of pathogens and their rapid mutation rate. The cost of this is that we have an increased rate of cancer, but cancer is generally a disease of older people. Yes, you can get leukemia as a child, you can get lymphoma as a child or a young adult. That's tragic, but it's very rare. Most cancers, including leukemias and lymphomas, occur in people my age or older. So, you know, for the most part, you've finished your child, your reproduction, you've survived this long, and whether you still live doesn't really affect whether your genes are passed along. So I think it's a very interesting evolutionary issue, and you think about the fact that it's only in the immune system and it's only in the cells that make antibodies and T-cell receptors. And that's because you need a tremendous amount of diversity. If you look in like flies and worms and invertebrates that don't have long lifespan and reach sexual maturity after a few days or weeks, they don't have adaptive immune systems that have variable domains. They just don't need it because the chances that they make a lot of offspring, and even if most of them don't survive, enough will live long enough to be able to reproduce. They don't need this very complicated and dangerous system for breaking DNA and mutating it. Okay, so now I want to take a minute and go over the question about flow cytometry that I brought up last week, and it's on the practice quiz. And the next slide has the answer. But the question is, you have a mixture of T cells and B cells from mouse lymph nodes. And one is from a normal mouse, one's from a mouse that lacks mature B cells. And I've asked you to draw a dot plot, one of these squares with a four different quadrants, what you'd expect to see when you run the two samples. They have stained with antibodies to the T cell receptor and to CD4. So let's assume for now, this isn't really true, but let's assume they're equal percentages of B cells and the two different types of CD8 T cells in the normal sample. And that we could forget about all the other cells that might be in a lymph node because they've been removed from the sample. So remember, the cells have been stained with antibodies that detect the T cell receptor and antibodies that detect CD4. These have different fluorescent tags on them so they can be distinguished from each other. So the answer is here. Here's the normal sample. I didn't label it. This is the mutant sample. Here's the normal sample. B cells aren't going to bind the antibodies to the T cell receptor or the antibodies to CD4. The CD4 or T helper cells will bind antibodies to both, and they'll be up here. And the CD8 cells, they'll have T cell receptors, so they'll bind that antibody, but they won't be bound by the anti-CD4 antibody. So the mistakes people made in this example last year on the midterm is that they didn't realize that there were, you know, they didn't know where to put the CD8 T cells. They didn't realize that the T cells, by being a T cell, they have to have a T cell receptor. So and an antibody that recognizes all T cell receptors through a constant epitope, well, all the T cells will bind that, but only those that also have CD4 will show up as double positive in this quadrant up here. And in the mutant, they'll still have CD4 cells and they'll have CD8 cells, but they won't have B cells anymore. As I told you, one is from a mouse lacking mature B cells. Now, you would get full credit if you put one dot over here, because I told you sometimes there's some background. And if the numbers of the dots were different, you might put 50 of them instead of 9 of them. But the important thing was that they're about the same numbers in these three quadrants, and that you had some in each of these three, and that you were missing B cells over here. This was probably the most challenging facts question I've had over the years. Other ones have been a little bit easier. So I thought if I gave you the most challenging one, that it would really help you understand the flow cytometry technique. But I still see a lot of confused faces. So please raise your hand if you have a question. Yeah? Because all cells, how can you know the B cells are there if the antibodies don't stain? All cells have a background fluorescence. when the laser light passes through them, even if there's no antibody bound with a fluorescent tag, there's an internal fluorescence. And so the cells always appear. If they're not binding the antibody, you set the machine so that they appear in this lower left quadrant. Yeah, it's basically, you know the cells are there, and you set the detection sensitivity so that you see the cells down here. Yeah. Right. So you know, if we didn't have the second assumption, we wouldn't know. This would be a mixture of B cells and other cells, and therefore, in the sample lacking B cells, you would still have some dots here that represented the other cells. There would just be fewer of them. Yeah.
And are those like relatively like the same percentage-ish?
Yeah, I made it so that there is exactly the same 9 dots in each. In a real facts experiment, you'd have tens of thousands of dots. Yeah. I mean, you will hear people going like that, you know, in the class. You know they're working on that problem. You can make 5 of them. You can make 50 of them. You know, it's up to you. Yeah, as long as it's clear that if you want to have one dot as a non-specific dot in a quadrant, make sure you have at least 5 or 6 in all the other ones. Otherwise, if you have 4 in one and 3 in the other, and you say this was non-specific, I can't tell the difference. So yeah. What?
Can we just write a number in the...
Yeah, you can write a number of 8 dots if you want. That's fine. It'll be quieter in here. Okay. I emphasize this because it's such a powerful tool, such an important tool, and this is really just the beginning. Remember I told you, you know, that you can distinguish the amount of fluorescence. So there might be some cells that have a lot more CD4 than others that have totally different function. And you can distinguish low CD4s from high CD4s. So the flow cytometry method is so fundamental and so useful in biology and in medicine that I think it's important that you understand it and you have the basics of being able to plot, you know, a 2-color plot or potentially a histogram of a single color experiment. Okay, so our little break for the day, that wasn't the break. I'm actually going to ask a question of the audience, which I haven't done that much yet in our breaks. Talk to your neighbor and answer for a minute and talk about, can you inject a mouse monoclonal antibody, this is the abbreviation for monoclonal antibody, into a human to treat a human disease, like cancer or autoimmunity? And then I'll ask you what your answer is after. Okay, who says yes, you can do this? All right, who says no? Well, you're both right. You can make the antibody initially in a mouse. Let's say it's a protein on the surface of a tumor, human tumor cell. You want to use antibodies to eradicate those tumors. You can inject the human tumor cells into a mouse, make a monoclonal antibody. But if you were to inject that directly into a human, it would be rejected as foreign. So basically what happens is, using molecular biology, the CDR loops, or the DNA encoding them, is grafted onto a human IgG gene. And then through recombinant DNA and protein production, you produce human Ig molecules that have the, you know, the DNA sequences that encode the antigen binding region that was generated by your mouse. So humanized antibodies are really, there's now probably 30 or 40 of them on the market for different human diseases. I just have a few shown here that are some of the most successful and biggest money makers. I don't think that the images are all that clear, but this is one that's called Herceptin that's used to treat one type of breast cancer, and that is responsible in large part for the success of the company Genentech. Rituximab, or Rituxan, binds a protein on the surface of all B cells known as CD20, and a lot of, I told you, B cell tumors that arise from mistakes in somatic recombination and so forth are treated by giving them antibodies that basically bind to and deplete B cells, including the tumor cells. And then antibodies to TNF-alpha, we learned about TNF-alpha as an inflammatory cytokine. When you make too much of it in your joints, you get arthritis, and many arthritis patients take antibodies that neutralize or block TNF-alpha and other, as well as in other inflammatory diseases.
Question?
Yeah. They're human antibodies. They just have the antigen binding site from the mouse. So you make the antibodies in the mouse, you make a hybridoma, and then you clone from the hybridoma the coding sequence of the heavy and light chains. And then using recombinant DNA, you basically just insert the CDR encoding regions into a clone that would produce a human IgG. So you just basically graft the variable region loops onto a human antibody. So the human antibody has all the effector functions of any human antibody that we'll talk about in the next lecture, or this half lecture and the beginning of the next. It's very clever, yeah.
So like the Ig region are the same?
Yeah, uh-huh. It's just a human antibody, but it's we can't just use human volunteers to generate antibodies. And if you injected a human being with a human CD20 protein, you wouldn't make an antibody response because it's not seen as foreign. So you have to use an animal to make that, to make the antibody first. And you have to be able to make a hybridoma that's a cell that you can grow that's clonal, that you can use to pull out the sequence and figure out what it is. Okay, so now we are going to talk about antibody isotypes. Here's my R-rated picture for the day. And as I told you, I think on the first day of class, people often complain that my part of this course, at least the first half before the midterm, is all about details of VDJ recombination and the different cell types and different make different isotypes. What does this actually do? So I decided I was going to move up this lecture on what the antibodies do to before the midterm, to give you a little bit of applied immunology and take away a little bit of the mechanism that we'll put after the midterm. Okay, so you can be invaded or attacked by a pathogen just about anywhere. The most common sites would be the lungs, respiratory tract, the digestive tract, the urogenital tract, and on your skin. And of course, the lungs and the mouth are part of the respiratory and digestive tracts. So basically, you need to have defense systems at all those sites. And that's why one reason we have different isotypes is because they're concentrated in different sites. And they're color-coded down here. And as we go through this lecture and the next lecture, we will go through them individually. So remember that the same antigen specificity can be linked to the different isotypes by class switching. And a single B cell can produce antibodies for the same antigen that provide all the protective functions appropriate for each body compartment. When I say single B cell, I mean single mother parental cell. The progeny, one might switch to make IgA that's found at these, in the gut and in the lungs. One might switch to make IgE, which is found beneath the skin and the epithelial surfaces, et cetera. So the same antigen binding event on a parental mother B cell can lead to eventually B cells attacking that antigen at different parts of the body. So now we're back to figure 432, and we're going to get into the details of this figure. We're not going to go to every single part of it, but a lot of it. And you can see that, so we'll start with this. IgM is the first isotype that's expressed on B cells when they come out of the bone marrow, and then they start to express IgD as well. But before they encounter antigen and they circulate around the body, B cells are expressing IgM on the surface along with IgD. And I told you earlier in this lecture that at the early stages of an immune response, before somatic hypermutation and class switching has finished, some plasma cells are generated that make IgM. And it tends to be low affinity because they come from cells that did not undergo somatic hypermutation. But this low affinity IgM is still very useful because it's actually created and created as a pentamer, and that's shown here, in which five different IgM molecules are disulfide linked together through the ends of their constant regions. And then it's all brought together by another protein known as the J chain, which forms disulfide bonds with two of the IgM molecules. Don't confuse the J chain with J gene segments. This is a protein, not a DNA sequence. And by having five IgM molecules, that gives you 10 antigen binding sites. And so even if the affinity of any one site isn't all that high, you have a phenomenon known as avidity, which is basically affinity times number of binding sites. And that means that when the IgM is secreted, even if you get some on-off rate of these binding to antigens, overall you tend to have high affinity. You can think of it like Velcro. If you just have one little bit of Velcro stuck to the other, it's easy to pull it off, but if they're all stuck together, then it requires a lot more effort. This is an electron micrograph of what an IgM molecule looks like, so it does actually look a bit like this picture here. But the one problem with IgM, because it's so large, it cannot diffuse out of the bloodstream. So if you remember, IgM is color-coded blue here. They're showing it in the heart as a representation of the vasculature, of the vascular system, arteries and veins. You do not find IgM molecules in the tissues or secreted into the body cavities. It's just too large. It can sometimes get into tissues during inflammation when the blood vessels are more leaky, but in general, IgM is confined to the bloodstream. And it's absolutely essential isotype there for preventing infections of the blood or blood-borne pathogens. And one way that it does that is because it's particularly good at activating complement. Now, even though IgM, as far as we know, does not have an Fc receptor on phagocytes, so it doesn't opsonize directly. Because it activates the complement system, leading to binding of C3b to the surface of pathogens, it indirectly opsonizes. Does that make sense? Okay. I don't want to give you the impression that IgM is only made early in the response. You can make IgM memory cells, or you can make IgM that's undergone somatic hypermutation but just never switched to a different isotype. So you can make higher affinity IgM, and you can make IgM in secondary and tertiary responses. But the most important function of IgM seems to be as an early isotype that's made as a pentamer to make up for low affinity that helps deal with pathogens in the blood, and it's really good at activating complement. What about IgG? You can see here that it's in the blood, but it's also in the tissues. It's the principal isotype in the extracellular fluid. And part of that is because it's a monomer. It's small enough to diffuse out of the blood into the tissues. But it's also actively transported by an Fc receptor that's known by two different names. In this book, they call it Fc receptor N. but more commonly it's known as Fc receptor B, capital B. Okay, so FCRB. And what happens is that, I'll go back to the other pointer. IgG in the blood will bind to this Fc receptor B, and that leads to endocytosis of the IgG and transport across the endothelial cell and release into the extracellular space. So some IgG can squeeze through the walls itself in between the endothelial cells, but some is actively transported. This will not bind IgM, so you don't get active transport of IgM. You'll notice in this middle panel that you find IgG in the fetal circulation, and that's because there's FCRB receptors at the placental surface that actively transport maternal IgG into the fetal bloodstream. So if you go back to figure 432, here's IgG transported across the placenta. And it also diffuses into these extravascular sites. You'll notice that some of the IgG isotypes, particularly 1 and 3, are good at activating complement and also good at opsonization. And that's a direct effect because Fc receptors on phagocytes can recognize IgG isotype, particularly IgG1, IgG3. And you'll also notice that it's given 3 pluses for neutralization. And we'll talk about neutralization in a minute. But basically, neutralization requires a really high affinity binding site. Why does IgG neutralize better than IgM? Because at the same time that class switching is occurring, somatocopy mutation is occurring. So as the constant region switches to IgG, or IgA, which is another isotype that can neutralize, you're getting somatocopy mutation and selection of high affinity antibodies. So IgM isn't so good at neutralizing because even as a pentamer, its affinity tends to be lower than a good IgG antibody. What about IgA? Well, I guess I'll start with this figure, and it shows that IgA is also a form, it can be a monomer, but can also be secreted as a dimer. And again, the J chain is involved in making disulfide bonds with two IgA molecules. This is what it looks like in reality. IgA is the principal isotype that's secreted into body cavities, like the lungs, the urogenital tract, the nasal, mouth, digestive tract. And it's also made in breast milk and then delivered to the baby through breastfeeding. So if you look at this picture, again, IgA is in yellow. You find it in those locations. You find it in breast milk. And I think I have just a couple minutes. I'll talk about how it's transported. So most IgA, dimeric IgA, is produced by plasma cells that are located in a region known as the lamina propria, which is an area that's under the basement membrane of many epithelial surfaces, in this case, the intestines. So just below the intestinal villi cells, epithelial cells, you have a basement membrane which serves as a partial barrier to pathogens. And below that is this area called the lamina propria where the plasma cells secrete dimeric IgA. This can cross the basement membrane. And when it gets to this side of the epithelial cell, there's a receptor known as the poly-Ig receptor, which binds to dimeric IgA, and then you get endocytosis and transport across the epithelial cell to what's known as the apical face of the cell, and now it's released into the lumen, in this case, let's say, of the gut, together with a little piece of the poly-Ig receptor known as the secretory component. So this process is called transcytosis. It's transport across the cell of dimeric IgA. It's mediated by the poly-Ig receptor, which does not bind other isotypes, and it results in secretion of dimeric IgA along with a secretory component. And the last concept, just to mention, is the fact that you can deliver maternal antibodies to the fetus during fetal development by IgG getting into the circulation and into the newborn through breast milk are examples of what's known as the passive transfer of immunity. It's different from vaccination, where you intentionally induce an immune response in the person or the animal. In this case, the mother is passively transferring her own immunity into the child through the placenta here or through breast milk here. Okay, so that's all I have time for today. We will pick up there on Wednesday.